Hi, I am excited to talk with you today about diagnostic schema, another really important reasoning concept. I'm Denise Connor, and I am the theme leader for CMC Clinical Reasoning, and then director of the Doctor Block. So I have three objectives for us today. The first is I want to be sure you can describe what a diagnostic schema is. There are many different types of schema. Today we're really focusing on diagnostic schema that we use to understand a complex clinical problem. And then I want you to be able to describe the purpose of a diagnostic schema, and lastly, when and how we use them. So for a given clinical problem or a given problem representation, you're going to be linking that with an approach or a diagnostic schema. So what that means is you're going to think about, first of all, what are the big buckets of disease that could account for that problem? Usually people do this either by organs or by systems, something at that higher level to help you just organize your thinking about that problem. So for example, for acute shortness of breath, maybe I think about these four big buckets as being the most common causes in my patient population for shortness of breath. So is it cardiac? Is it pulmonary? Is it metabolic? Is it heme? And that would be actually a fine starting point. Maybe I stop there. Or maybe my schema is even a little bit more elaborate, and under some of those buckets, I've developed some subcategories. Those subcategories might be specific diagnoses. So for like cardiac and heme, perhaps I think heart failure, CHF, or acute coronary syndrome, or arrhythmia are common causes for cardiac shortness of breath. And for hematologic causes, maybe I only have one idea, and that's anemia. So those are examples of diagnoses that fit in those buckets. But maybe I also might think about this in terms of another level of category. So for pulmonary, maybe I think about this anatomically. And so I think, okay, pulmonary could be airway disease. It could be the alveoli or the interstitium. It could be vascular. Just as by way of example. So then under each of those categories, maybe then I kind of delineate the different diagnoses. The key thing here is this is just a framework for me to organize my thinking about a complex problem that can have many different causes. And it allows me to make sense of that clinical problem. I want you to remember that there's no gold standard schema. So there's not one perfect one out there that I want all of you to end up having in your mind. It's more that you want a schema that makes sense to you, that's contextualized within your medical knowledge, based on whatever clinical experiences you've had so far, that is something that you'll be able to actually hold in your mind. Because just like illness scripts, while in our practice, we talk about these explicitly and write them down and discuss them, in the clinical world, these are all going to live in our mind. So we want to be building them in a way that really makes sense to us. And the other thing I will say is, what you start with will not be what you end up with. So these will change over time with experience. You will build these out more. You may change the categories. You may lump certain categories together or add a new category. And that is how this should go. So don't feel like whatever you start with the first time you think about your framework for a problem is what you're going to end up with. If you ask three different clinicians what their approach to shortness of breath is, they're going to give you very different answers based on their patient population and their clinical experience, and that's just fine. The other thing about schema is the problem representation, just as in your clinical encounters, that's going to change and become more specific throughout an encounter. You may develop schema initially just for acute shortness of breath, but later you might have acute shortness of breath in an elderly man, acute shortness of breath in a young woman, and you might have different schema for those different patient populations. And while the buckets may remain the same, what's more common in a given patient population may also be data that you encode in your schema. So for example, acute shortness of breath in an elderly man, for example, an elderly veteran, which are patients I see a lot, they're going to have a very different, most likely bucket that they fall into compared to a young woman. So cardiac and pulmonary may become much more important in my patient population, and only if I don't think they fit in there will I then think about my other buckets. So remember that these schema encode specific systems or organ systems, they encode potential diagnoses, but they also encode relative likelihood of those diagnoses. And all of that will help you when you're thinking through a clinical problem. So why use a diagnostic schema? So what you'll find, especially when you just start seeing patients, is that the information that's coming at you, if you don't have a way to organize it, can become quite chaotic, and it can be hard to process in the moment with a patient. It can be hard in that encounter to be hypothesis-driven if you're kind of overwhelmed by all the different information that's coming at you. So a schema can take that data and help you to kind of organize it. You can take what the patient's telling you and begin to put it into different buckets. And that allows you to sort of make sense of what they're telling you and allows you a way into the problem, which otherwise may feel a little bit overwhelming. So it's a really important tool to kind of keep you organized and keep you hypothesis driven during your exam and your history. So when do we use a diagnostic schema? There are several points within the encounter and after the encounter where I think it's really helpful to consider your diagnostic schema. So the first time is right before you even go to see the patient. So when you're given a new patient, oftentimes you'll have a chief complaint from a triage nurse, or your resident or your fellow may give you a little bit of sign out, a one-liner about that patient. So you usually have a sense of what is the main problem that I think I'm trying to solve. So before you walk into the room, just take a minute. Think of this as a sort of your first diagnostic kind of timeout and think, okay, this person has a cough. Do I have an approach to cough? What are the different systems that could be involved here? What are the organ systems that could be involved here? What are my big buckets? And even if you just go in with those big buckets, not with anything more specific, that's going to help you to organize your thinking and to understand and be able to process what the patient is telling you. So it's a really good thing to get in the habit of doing as sort of a check before you go in to see your patient. Now, if you can't tell, this is salt. So I want you to take what I just said with many grains of salt. Because, as you can imagine, what you think the person might have, what the triage nurse chief complaint is, or what the sign out is, may be wrong, and in fact, not infrequently is wrong. So maybe you heard that the patient had hemoptysis, or they were coughing up blood, but actually they have hematemesis, they're vomiting blood. As you can imagine, the schema, the diagnostic schema, the buckets for those two problems are completely different. So if you're too tied to your schema when you go in to see your patient, sometimes you can be seeing them through a very narrow lens that makes it so that you can't actually get to the bottom of what's going on with them. So the first rule of thumb is while you did that diagnostic sort of timeout before you went into the room, be flexible. Don't be too tied to your schema. Let the patient sort of guide you when you get into the room. And the second thing is our schema are often not complete. So you may have four buckets, maybe there's six buckets, and there's two others that you didn't even think of. So there are many reasons why it's important to let the patient sort of tell their story and to let them flesh it out before we get to the hypothesis-driven, close-ended questions in a history and physical exam. But one of those reasons is because if we're too tied to our schema and too tied to imagining what are the, 10 close-ended questions I must ask to differentiate these different buckets, I can miss that actually they don't fit into any of those buckets. They fit over here and it's something I didn't think about. So the point, one of the points, in addition to building rapport and having the patient feel safe with you, of letting them tell their story and really flesh that out before you get to those questions, is to be sure that if you're in a totally different place than where you thought, maybe this is actually sounding rheumatologic, and that wasn't on your list at all, you can be cued by that to then go ahead and ask those questions later on in the interview. Ask the review systems that's related to rheumatology that you might not have thought to do if you had just been really tied to your schema. So while the schema helps you to organize your thinking, to understand what's coming at you and be able to kind of put it into discrete buckets, you don't want to be stuck there. So the first a couple of times where a schema is important to consider, we talked about before you go into the patient's room, while you're in the patient's room, being flexible and moving it around based on the evolving problem presentation that you have with that patient. And then the last time that's really important to think about your schema is when you're done. You're out of the room, you're sitting down to write your note or prepare your oral presentation. That is the next time that you really want to be thinking about your schema. Because it's going to allow you to organize your differential diagnosis in a way that has some structure. It will allow you to be sure that you didn't miss a big category. So perhaps by the end of your encounter, you had a certain problem that you felt you were trying to solve, and your schema wasn't totally complete for that problem. You hadn't seen it before. You come out of the room, you're going to do a little bit of research and realize, oh, there was a whole nother bucket over here that I didn't consider, and actually I need to go back and ask that patient some more questions or do some more physical exam maneuvers that I hadn't thought of. Remember that that's totally fine and normal to do. In the inpatient setting, all the time we go back and say, oh, I'm sorry, I wanted to ask you a few more questions, or can I do this one more part of the exam to help me really get a full picture of what's going on here? In the outpatient setting, you might make that a plan that next time the patient returns, you're going to be sure to do this additional physical exam maneuver or ask these additional questions because you kind of neglected this one category that could be going on with the patient. So taking some time to reflect on your schema can organize your differential diagnosis, make sure you haven't missed anything, and allow you to decide you need to gather more data to be sure what's going on with your patient. So thanks for listening. Please feel free to email me with any questions you might have. I love talking about reasoning, and I look forward to seeing you apply these concepts in your reasoning workshops. The next video that you'll be watching is called Script Smart, and it is going to be given to you by a medical student named Max Pillsbury. We've been working on this concept to help you organize your kind of growing clinical knowledge, and feel free to reach out to me with any questions about using or getting started with Script Smart. Thanks.